I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. Who is and who was and is to come, I am the Almighty. And he fell down at his feet. And Jesus said, I am the one who lives and was dead. And behold, I am alive evermore. Amen. And I have the keys of death and hell. My translation of that is, I was here in the beginning. I will be here in the end. And I am here now. My focus tonight is on the two words that is nestled between the time zones of yesterday and forever and today. The place where you and I live, the zone where we hang our hat, is the zone that's between yesterday and the past and the future. As I study God's word, there are three dimensions of time in which Christ operates. He is the Christ of the proven past. Glory be to his name. He is the Christ of the promised future. And he is the Christ of our present reality, the pressing present. Our God is a present day God. And we cannot forget it. He is the same in all three dimensions. It is easy to look to the proven past and have confidence and believe who he is. I mean, look at it. There's no doubt our God is a God of the past. It is easy to look to the promised future, and what a hope the Christian has, and what a confidence and belief it puts within our soul tonight. This world's not our home. We are just a passing through. Read the back of the book. It looks pretty good. It looks real good. He will always be almighty. But in the and today, in the present reality, it is easy to lose sight of the fact that he is the same almighty God when all hell is breaking loose against you. When you're faced with that circumstance and you get that phone call, it's easy for Satan to rattle you that God is the same in today. Vance Havner said, it's easy to visualize the Christ of Galilean past and the Christ of the glorious future than to expect great things from the Christ of the glamorless now, the place where we operate. It is a conclusion and conviction in my life and ministry that there are four destinations where people dwell. There is the dwelling place of those who are always worshiping the past. They're always looking over their shoulder. They're always proclaiming how wonderful it used to be. There's the dwelling place of those who are always wishing for the future, always pushing God around the next corner, but never getting there. I kind of was in that camp for a while, where I was just pushing God. But then the Lord just woke me up. And I woke up. And I said, God, this is my time. And God, you can do something in my day. And my life has been radically changed. There's those who are in the dwelling place of always weeping over the present. They're cursing the darkness, but shamefully, they're not coming up with the solutions of the cure. Boy, they just love to curse the darkness. They just like to spread gloom, doom, and despair. And they do very little or nothing productive to change it. I hear phrases like this. Oh, I wouldn't want to be raising my children today. Can I just be real, just kind of honest? That just really makes me mad. That just really, really frustrates me. It really does. I just had to get that out. There were moments in my pastoring where I became so, I'm a transparent guy, okay? Did you know that? You probably could tell. I caught myself getting so upset with some people in my pew because I wanted to move. And the Lord stopped me one day and said, you're so upset, you can't help them a lick. You can't help them at all because you're so angry. We can't just curse the darkness. And then there's the dwelling place of those who are willing to trust God for their day and work with conviction in their soul that God is able. To be real honest, it takes far less grace and far less faith to live in one of the first three destinations than to live in the fourth, a present reality. It's easier to believe in anything but reality. That goes from the White House right down to maybe my house. Take a look at what is sweeping our world. We're in the world of virtual reality. I kind of put virtual reality as living in a zone of non-existent victory. Victory somewhere. But it can't be touched. It can't be real. And I'm afraid this mentality slipped into our churches. Kind of a virtual zone. You can have a virtual bowling ball. You can have a virtual gun. You can have a virtual this and that. Somewhere is somewhere on that screen or out in space. But you don't possess one thing of it. Amen? I will not be satisfied with any answer but living in the present. Today I can be saved. Today I can be sanctified. Today I can be cleansed. Today I can see God move. Today God's kingdom can be built in my setting. I'm not living in any other generation. I'm not going to live in any other generation. This is my time. This is my day. This is a time that God has called me and you. Furthermore, God's word doesn't promise tomorrow. Doesn't promise us tomorrow. Sufficient unto the day. Nor does God place upon us the call to the past. Read his word. Why are you saying the cause of the former days are better than these? You're not wise concerning these things. That's from the word. That's kind of important. That's from the word. Christ himself even said in John 3:17, we usually leave John 3:17 out. We say 3:16. He said, I did not come into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. And besides all this, God's word is filled with verses that declare that he is the God of our present reality. I just read again in Hebrews chapter 3 and 4 five times. In those passages, the Holy Spirit will say, today if you'll hear my voice. 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 2 Corinthians 6:2 says, behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the time of salvation. Today is the time that God has chosen. Today is the opportunity for God's harvest to happen. Today God is showing his favor and calling. I am convinced God has not relegated the best of himself to the past, but God has positioned himself ready to take on the present in any generation. God's best is yet to come. God's best operates in our today. God's best is in our tomorrows. My heart just lit up during the song service when I saw all these young people and something just came over my soul. Listen, young people, the best is not in the past. The best is not in the past. The best is in the future and the best is in our present. And I believe that with all my heart. God has always been at his best in the present. God has always done what he did in the present. We can't afford to become a museum. We can't afford to just have a shelf of trophies all in the past. We can't afford to miss the mission that God has sent us on. I've been reading through Numbers. Numbers 13 is one of the saddest passages. They failed to catch the mission of God and go into the promised land. And 40 years they went around and around and around. 600,000, little over 600,000 graves instead of 600,000 condos. Yep. Because they won't believe God. Was the challenge bigger than who they were? You better believe it. But not with God. God had already promised. And doesn't he promise us that he'll be with us? Doesn't he promise that he's going to be with us until the end? Oh, I don't want to miss it. They were digging graves instead of digging foundations for their home. That's the truth. And God is in the present. You know, sometimes we look back at the Bible and see all those heroes. But you know what? When they were living, they were in there today. And God showed up. Abraham was going up a mountain. But God showed up. Joseph went down to Egypt. But God showed up. Elijah was on Mount Carmel. And he made some pretty bold claims. And he prayed a short prayer. And God showed up. Amen. David was facing Goliath with just a little old slingshot. I've been running the other way. All the Israelites were hiding under the tent, under the tent flaps, and under the wagons. And the word says David ran, and God showed up. Daniel and the three Hebrew children. They said, we're not going to bend and we're not going to bow. You can do what you want to with us, but we're going to serve our God. And I think the scripture says that someone showed up in the fire. And an ungodly man and heathen. I think that looks like, yeah, the Christ I just said is the same yesterday, today, and forever. I read my bio about Esther and Mordecai. And Mordecai goes to Esther and he says, I think you were born for such a time as this. And she marched into that king and God showed up. God showed up. And then I read about a little girl named Mary. That when the angel appeared to her, let it so be unto thy handmaid. And Christ showed up. And then I read on the third day after he died on the cross, it wasn't some virtual reality of a Christ. But my friends, he came out of that grave victorious over sin and over death and over hell. He was a present God giving present victory. Hallelujah. And he's the God we serve tonight. Hallelujah. I wish I could have been there when the guards fell down flat. And the stone was rolled away. That was a present God that was stepping out. I do too. I say glory. The apostles, they really didn't have too good of resumes. Disciples didn't have much either. But they got filled with the Holy Spirit. And they went out. And God showed up everywhere. He showed up everywhere. He showed up in towns. He showed up in the back alleys. Well, that's just like my God anyway, isn't it? Christ walked the back alleys and he walked there. And the present Christ touched people. And he's still alive today. I was reading through the book of Acts one day. I try to read the Bible, you know. Let me just stop here. Young boys who want to preach, or not just want to preach, you're called. Don't just read the Bible to get a sermon. When I go to my study, I'm there for the bread of heaven to feed my soul. If a sermon comes, a sermon will come. And whenever God wants to lay truth on my heart to burn, he can burn. But there's one thing, Deron Foreman, when he gets behind the pulpit on a Sunday morning, he's going to have fed his mind on Scripture because I'm a soul. That's good. That's good. That's good right there. That's good preaching right there. That is. Because I got to be filled with the bread. That was just extra. I don't have to charge for that. But I realize the book of Acts just stopped so abruptly. And the Holy Spirit told me the end of the story hadn't been written yet. And he takes the pen and he hands it off. I'm convinced. I'm convinced. I believe we have a misconception that we start kind of one leg down in the race from like the apostles and all those. And the Lord been burning on my heart just this truth recently. I'm not elevating. Friends, God's not going to duplicate in a cookie cutter duplication what happened in Acts. But he's going to develop. Oh, he's going to develop what he's going to do in this day that is fresh. I believe that. And back to all those apostles, I read down through that list in Hebrews. Some of them had some quirks. And I believe it's the Holy Spirit that's working my heart out. He's not telling us that we're a lap down already. And some of us go out into ministry, myself included, thinking, I can never match up. Please, let's put that to rest. I'm serious. That may sound braggadocious, and if, just think about it a while, okay? I believe that we're writing the rest of the story right now. I'm part of writing. It's not going to be inspired where God's not going to pen what I do in the Word. But somewhere He's writing. Somewhere He's writing. And you and I have a chance. I turned over Hebrews chapter 11. And I, wow, look at all these giants. And then I realized I was in there. Did you know I was in the faith chapter? I'm serious. You are too. Listen to the last verses. And all these obtained a good report through faith, testimony. They didn't receive the promise. Here it is. Listen. God having provided something better for us. I highlighted it. That they, all the heroes, are not made perfect, or they're not complete. This race is not complete until it's my part. My part. And then I went on to the 12th chapter. Therefore. You know what that is? That's a baton move. Therefore, let us run the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the same one. I want to give you $1 million for what I'm holding in my hand right now. You know who gave that to me? My daddy. That I just lost 4 months ago. 14 years ago, we were sitting around a nice cabin in Gatlinburg, Tennessee. All of wonderful people, and we was just all there. And Dad had devotions the last day. We didn't know he was going to do it. But he cut little pieces of PVC pipe and he put on here from Mom and Dad. And he read that scripture in Hebrews. And at the end of that devotional, he walked around that circle. He said, someday Mom and Dad's going to be gone. And it's your turn. It's your turn. That's valuable. And I see God. I see our Lord handing the baton out today. Will you take it? Will you take it? Will you run your race? I'll be there. I'll be there just like I was back then. I'll be there just like I will be in the end. I'll be the Almighty. I'll be the Almighty. I'll be the Almighty. I'll build my church. I've had the distinct privilege of being almost 22 years at the same place. And I've seen the present God show up. You know, it just hadn't been like a glory trot. There's work. There's work. But I'm not a quitter. I'm not a quitter. I was really conscientious. Well, I still am. But I was overly conscientious. But God built something in me that I wasn't going to quit. And there's something in me. I'm not going to quit. I'm not going to quit. Young people, find a place where God placed you and stick in there and build the kingdom of God. I've had some longevity. Praise God, I have. Build God's kingdom so people have to love you. My conference president, please don't listen to this. I don't even know what year of call I'm on. We just really love each other. Can you believe that? I think we do. At least they love my wife and they vote me in. You know what that does? I can see the seasons and I can see the movings of God. And that little storefront where we started behind in a shopping plaza, behind the old Kroger's grocery store that was selling groceries. We started right behind that building in a little storefront. And then for the last 14 years, we've been parking in the front of that grocery store. And now God gave us that. God gave us that property. After 30 some years. I'm kind of a late bloomer. I really am. I feel like I am. But you know what? The easiest thing for me to do right now, easiest thing for me to do, listen to me, would just be comfortable. I've got a good church, and the offerings are good right now, and have been. And the easiest thing for me, that's a disclaimer, but the easiest thing to do would be just, I think I'll just coast the rest of my. I think I'll just, God's been stirring me up. And I thought, you know what? God didn't step out, he stepped in. God stepped into the garden, he didn't step out. And Christ stepped into the cross, he didn't step out. And Satan is playing a trick, and Satan has a temptation going around right now. A little sly temptation. With all this physical and emotional and spiritual exhaustion, the tendency is want to check out. I've heard a lot of comments, I can't wait till the Lord comes back. Boy, I tell you what, I'm just getting tired of this. And I've said some of those too. But when I hear those comments, it's like, wait. Does our children need to see us drawing exit plans? Or engagement plans? Is it exit or engagement? God's calling us to engage. He's not calling us to exit. Brother Faye told us today, not isolation, penetration. The easiest thing to do is step out, quit, give up, go home to your mom. Whatever. But Christ didn't do that. On earth, peace, goodwill toward men. A present day God, a present day Christ needs a present day Christian. What does it take? What does it take to be a present day Christian? Praise God. Friends, this is not a day to be pulling the lever and sliding down the escape hatch. It's time for the church to be the church. It's time for the church to be the church with all this exhaustion. Let me give you a passage of scripture and then try to wrap this up. You've been here a long time. This is what I feel like from the scripture that a present-day Christian, this is what it'll take. And knowing the time that is high time to awake out of our sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is far spent. The day is at hand. Let us cast off the works of darkness and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk properly as in the day and put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. A present Christ needs present Christians. Amen. It is. You know, outreach is just not some impulse of enthusiasm. It's a steady stream. It's working it. Going forward. It's sticking to the stuff. Amen? All these pyramid things. Everybody's just trying to sign people up, but no one's selling the product. I caught on pretty quick. Where's the boots on the ground? You just want me to give you money, so I'm under you. Who's selling the product? It's getting real quiet, but I'm trying to make an illustration here. There's got to be boots on the ground. We got to see it in our day. Amen? The proof is in the pudding. It's time to, the criteria or the characteristics. Wake up. Wake up, it says. We must be people that are clear. Clear-minded. We must be people that are clean. We must be people that are clothed. And we must be people who are commissioned. Amen? Look around. Darkness is everywhere. But Christ is still the same. He's powerful. He's positioned to help. And he's providing salvation. The call is still the same. God is saying, Christ is saying, here I am. Are we saying, here I am? The cause is still the same. David said, is there not a cause? The cause is his kingdom and his harvest. It's about victory and the triumph of grace. Grace is going to triumph. The cross is going to win. Christ did not die in vain. The cross is going to win. Christ is going to win. Grace is going to conquer and is conquering now. We win. We win. And the conditional promise is the same. Jesus Christ said, go ye into the world and I'll go with you into the end. I want us to stand. I want the pianist to come. I've done my best to unload my heart tonight. We're all tired. But I ask God, whatever you need to do in my heart and whatever you need to do in our hearts, I want you to do it. I told you I'm going to be 55. And the project that we're doing there at Port Clinton is beyond human ability without God. Mark, I was thinking while you was talking, God's raised you in a bigger arena, but I was trying to break it down on a local level. You know, some of us need $1 million. By God's grace, he gave us that property. And by God's grace, we're going to build church in there. The property's already paid for. God paid that in less than a year. Right by the lake, 3.5 acres. All paved parking lot. Right there. We're going to put a youth center and a children's center in the back. We're going to do it. There's nothing for the young people in that town. And we're going to bus them in. We're going to put some equipment there. It'll make them want to come. And God just put it on my heart. They come in that community life center on the backside. They're going to come on the front side. And they're going to see what's going on. I wasn't going to show you this. But I'm going to. Right there. After my father died. We read that. The circle maker, about praying and having circles. And my dad wrote 6 things down that he wanted to see accomplished. And then he started to put X's through. He prayed that my boy Alex would get a promotion and an X's through. I didn't want my dad to die 3 days.
And he was a great man. Hey, can I just stop? I know we're sick. Can I just stop? Fathers, would you do something for me? Would you give your children affirmation? My father grew up in a generation, nobody told him that he loved him. Buddy, I'm being transparent tonight. I wasn't in an abusive home. My dad and I had a very good relationship. But I was always preaching. But Brother Faye, the last 8 years, my dad moved up and he became my best supporter. And we went down the road many times. He said, boy, he said, when you was called to preach, he said, I told mom, I think God got the call wrong. And he told me that one day. And then he turned, oh, thank God. Then he looked across at me in the car. He said, son, you're my favorite preacher. I wouldn't give you anything for that. And then I've been realizing, as my earthly father gave me affirmation, Mark, my ministry kind of went to a new zenith. I began to get some confidence. I don't have to be like any other preachers that are out here that can preach a lot better than what I can. I don't have to be anybody but me. The second circle that is X through. My dad prayed through that we was going to get our $1 million. And I found that after he died, he had X'd it through. You know what? I'm serious. The easiest thing for me to do right now is not to go in my office that is just across the way from that building and just say, I'm going to trust God. It'd be, you understand what I mean? It'd be easier for me to close the shades and say, I'm comfortable. But God has not called us to be comfortable or to do what is convenient. And after I checked my commitment to God, I found out I'm His. And if He wants me to do it and it puts me in the grave doing it, then so be it. I'm in. I've drawn the line again. I've drawn a line and stepped over it. I'm not checking out. I'm not checking out. I see God wanting to do more today than He's ever done. I know I end up just like yelling. And my people just like to hear it. Or it seemed like it. Hey, they've kept me. And I thought, boy, if I flop here, I'll just go back home. I got their credit card in my wallet. They'll pay my gas home. You don't have to give me a cent because they want me back. One of the new ladies has come and said, hey, don't preach too good. They'll ask you again. Kind of mess up. I'm saying this, young boys and everybody here. I'd rather preach than be anything. I mean that. And it's not because I think I'm good. I wanted to. This is what God's called me to do. And I'm not going to quit. Do I mess up and resign about every Monday? Yeah. Well, not as many times as I used to. But I'm not checking out. I'm in. Are you in? Are you in? Are you in? We're not playing games. We don't have time to play games. We don't have time to walk around 40 years. I wonder who will just come right here, right now, and say, I'm in. I want people to come up by me. Right now, I'm in. I'm in. I'm in. I'm in. Jesus, you can take me. You can have me. Call me where you want me to go. The first time I stepped in that storefront building, that snow blew in the sanctuary when you opened it. They brought me for a little revival in January 22 years ago to just see if it was a combination. When I drove into that parking lot, something happened in my soul before I stepped through the door. I said, this is it. This is it. And God's done great things. He's helped us. He's helped us. And He's going to do it again. Praise God. I want my conference president to come right up here and say a closing prayer. Come here, Brother Chris. Can you believe he even puts up with me? You know why? It doesn't matter the denomination. We're building a kingdom.
Yeah, that's right.
And I do have his back.
Yeah.
I kind of am the PR guy. And I have his back. I think I'm a good one. But we're trying to build a kingdom. And it's teamwork. Team up. We can't do this alone, Brother Jacob. I love you, my friend. Let's trust God. We're in. Would you please say a closing prayer? Have thine own way, God.
Amen.
Maybe somebody will be called tonight. Thank God.
Let's just all pray together, shall we? Our Father and our God, we are so aware you are with us. We felt your anointing fall on your servant. Holy Spirit, you're the one speaking. You speak to us. Oh God, hear our prayers. Thank you for your faithfulness to us. Thank you for this incredible reminder tonight. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for being in this place. Oh God, as before, shake the house, and fill every heart. Oh Lord, may it be so. May it be more than just lip service or just an emotional moment, but may it be an encounter with the divine tonight. Those discouraged hearts tonight, encourage them. Those that feel like they're losing in the battle, remind them the battle's not theirs, but it's yours. Remind us tonight that you are the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end. You're the creator. You're the sovereign God of the universe. You're the one who's revealed himself to all mankind through your son, Jesus, who ministers grace in us, for us, and through us, through the ministry of your Holy Spirit that's called us to the mission and cause of the church, the kingdom. I pray that you will equip your people tonight. Fill us with a fresh fullness of the Holy Spirit, a fresh baptism from above. Equip us for the work that is before us, Lord. Lord, it does not matter what church we belong to, so as for Christ, we stand, and whatever our label may be tonight, we lay them down. And around this altar, we are one. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one mission. Oh, thank you for that, Lord. Thank you for this word tonight, your word. Thank you for the anointing on your messenger. Lord, we will leave here tonight. We will not be the same. We will not be the same, and for that we are grateful. And we give thanks in the blessed name that is above every name, in the name that gives us victory and authority, in the name of Jesus our Lord.
Amen. You're dismissed. God bless you.